Hey, Randy Joe here, and welcome back to Folk February, the series where I'm listening to a different folk album every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Today we're going to be listening to Elliot Smith's 1997 album, Either Or. This is often regarded as Elliot Smith's best album, if not at least among one of the best. And I've never personally listened to an Elliot Smith album, to be completely honest, and that comes as a shock to some people when I tell them that, given the fact that Elliot Smith is such a, you know, monumental figure, especially within the folk scene or the indie scene. But I personally have never, I don't think I've even heard a single song from him other than just small snippets online. So this is like the most first reaction you could possibly get. I do not know what to expect other than the fact that I know he has a very quiet, soft tone. And that his lyrics are often very dense and poetic. And he usually has a more stripped back approach, you know. Kind of like the combination of those three things is all I know about him. So, again, this is a first reaction. I'm sure this album, if I do not like it right away, is one that will take more listens to grow on me. But I'm going into this with a pretty high expectation, which could be a bad thing. But let's just go into it. 36 minutes. Let's not waste too much time here. Speed Trials is the first song. Very ominous tone to this track. I like the kind of double layered vocals that he's doing. I really like this song. I really like the instrumentation. It has that lo-fi feel and there's like a slight buzzing. I think that kind of adds to the atmosphere. Very, very tinny like instrumentation. I'm liking the kind of delivery of this one overall, just everything about it. Really hard to decipher what this is even really about, but I do like the atmosphere and the kind of sweet, delicate lyrics here. Not sure what this is about. Not sure if it's optimistic or negative. It's really hard to decipher, but I will say I did like the overall tone, delivery, and direction of that track. I thought it was really nice. Next we're going to El Meta. Ooh. The production right on this one too is definitely much cleaner, more polished. I love just the very gentle backup vocals here too. I'm assuming production and, you know, pretty much everything that has to do with this album is all done by Elliot himself, which if that's the case, bravo, because it is very well balanced, has a lot of, you know, sense of chemistry, and just the like the mixing of the backup vocals as well as the main vocals and the clean production just feels like there's a lot going on for one artist to sort of put through. I really love this. It's about a guy who just assumes a girl likes him and he's been rejected and maybe he's realizing that he's not as valuable as he thought. I don't know. Really well mixed. There's everything about this track too is just so beautifully dynamic. Very soft, dreamy kind of style. It's like a depressed Jack Johnson. Man, that was a great track. Very different from that opener. But I loved both of them. Ballad of Big Nothing is this one. I'm going to try to interpret the lyrics as best as I can without looking too much at the Genius annotations. Just for a more pure first reaction. I really like the delicate nature of the production on this album. Like it's, like this has like an upbeat tone to it, but it still has a sense of melancholy. I really love the tinny drums on this album. It's about a person who is very selfish and maybe is ending up alone because of that. It's about a drug user maybe, like somebody who's throwing their life away into a drug addiction. Thinking the candy is metaphorical. I really love this one. That was a great track. Not even fully done yet, but I gotta say, like, just a great, beautiful, depressing track. A little bit of humor in it, I would say. But yeah, I think it's about a drug user. Next, we're going to Between the Bars. This is the most famous song on the album. 177 million streams on Spotify. Only 2 minutes. Really love his distinct vocal style. It's about going for a drink and forgetting about your problems. Not too sure though. Hard to. Could be too. Take it too literal. Maybe it's about alcoholism. I believe. This is a hard one for me to really think about. Like, is this from the perspective of the alcohol? Is this some sort of, like, calling from the alcohol to this alcoholic and controlling their life, in a sense, by making it seem so persuasive? Really sweet instrumentation, despite very depressing tones and lyrics. But that was a great one. Very short, but powerful. Next, we're going to go to Pictures of Me. Oh, this is a very punchy instrumental. It's far more upbeat than anything we've heard so far. Bordering into folk rock. I really love the simple, punchy instrumental here. Like, it's just a simple, like, you know, banging. But the way it's evolving and developing, each instrument kind of adding on to the next. But like stuff like this, oh, completely just changes up. Very dynamic album, which I did not expect. I expected something very stripped back, something similar to something like Pink Moon. Has a nice throwback, upbeat sound despite the depressing tone. Everybody's dying just to get the disease. A very ironic, tongue-in-cheek line. Seems like Smith, Elliot Smith, employs a little bit of humor within his tongue-in-cheek lyrics. You know, like there's a sense of awareness. Poking fun at the melodramatic, almost. This one's No Name Number 5. Not to be confused with Mambo Number 5. A masterpiece. In some certain ways. I think this is about just being lonely. That's what I'm gathering here. Isolating yourself. Given the very stripped back instrumentals, it really adds to that desolate atmosphere. Ooh. Like a warm hug. That instrumental just wraps around you. It's just like songwriting masterpieces, one after another. I love how everything feels like it's subtle, yet not so subtle that, you know, you're completely missing the point. There's a sense of relatability without being so blunt within the lyrics. So far, every song I have liked it, which to me, you know, I only like a song if I think it's, like, very, you know, of quality. Like, something I would probably rate an 8 or 10, or 8 or higher, I should say. So far, this has been a solid, solid, solid LP. Next, we got Rose Parade. 3 minutes, 28 seconds, 11 million streams. Let's see if it continues this hot streak of just beautiful tracks. Bit of a silly line. One of the sillier lines we've heard. But man, using the word like cavalcade, what a beautiful word. The guitar playing as well, I mean, I haven't noted it, but it's been stellar in matching his cadence. I really love, you know, it's a formula that's working here, is the slow start that kind of has an instrumental that swells in that second half. Like this part? Hmm. That guitar just matching his vocals. It's simple, but really just all comes together. A lot of lines about alcohol and drinking throughout this album so far. And themes of it. A lot of self-pitying on this one. Like a sense of self-importance while at the same time really having a sense of self-loathing. Next we've got Punch and Judy. That bass line there was really unexpected, but nice. This one has a very easygoing tone to it. Not too sure what the lyrics are suggesting here, but I do like the very easygoing, dreamlike tone of this one. Alright, going to the next track here. I think it's called Angela's? Fast, you know, guitar plucking. A staple in the folk genre. Sounds like it's a song about, you know, gambling with love, like shooting your shot. Maybe the narrator here is being played by this girl. I thought maybe it had to do with Los Angeles, but I'm not too sure. Given the fact that here it says he's from Portland, Oregon, so I don't know. If you're a fan of Smith, let me know. You know, why is it called Angela's? Is it a girl? Is it the place? Is there a piece of history I'm missing here? Inform me. But I do like this one. I like all these tracks, but if I'm being honest with you, I think every track here has been just beautiful. Cupid's Trick is the next one here. Song after song, track after track has been breathtaking. Really good cohesiveness as well. If this is how I'm feeling now, I can't imagine a few listens from now when this thing's really sunk in. The drumming on this, honestly, all the instruments, but the holy shit. This really has like an alt-rock tone as well to it. This is like an alt-rock album, you know, rooted in folk. Oh, it's getting like darker and grittier. This guitar passage is just really just like guiding the listener. Almost like on a wave. Another great track. I really love just how much this album keeps shifting in tone back and forth between the more, you know, alt rock elements and the more stripped back folk tracks as well. Got a nice balance here. This one though, 2:45 AM is the name of this one. I'm not sure what this one's about, but his vocals are very distinct and clear this time around. Definitely placed an importance on it, but I'm not sure. Thought maybe this was like some sort of abuse. Maybe an abusive relationship or abusive parental figure. Like a suicide note of a track. I really love the stripped back approach, and here we go, swinging right into it. Definitely a staple within this album so far is this, you know, slow building track that envelops in the back end. Good track. I loved how stripped back it was, but probably one of the most depressing ones, it feels like. I think it was a suicide note. Next, we've got Say Yes, final track here. Second most popular, 75 million streams. This one's got a nice, just like gentle, uplifting tone. Despite the fact that the lyrics seem very, you know, sad and melancholic. Maybe there's a sense of optimism, a better sweetness. Think it's about coming out the other end of a breakup in a positive fashion. Great track. Really just great album. I like that one. I think it's about some sort of heartbreak, but again, I do not know. I don't think this is going to be something that I necessarily pick up on everything right away. Say Yes felt very hopeful in its delivery, so I think it's about, you know, coming out the other side of a relationship in a positive fashion and you know, not being depressed, which considering most of this album has a very depressive tone, that's probably the most uplifting thing on here. But at 36 minutes and 58 seconds, every track here was phenomenal, if I'm being completely honest. And if this was a first listen, I feel like this is only going to grow on me more and more the more I hear it. So, great album, a great addition to Folk February. Consider me an Elliot Smith fan. Right here, right now, I will say that if this is what his music's like, I gotta dive into the rest of his discography because I feel like I have been severely missing out all this time. Clear blind spot as a music fan. So I will check out more of his work for sure. Don't know if I'll do more reactions to it, unless, of course, you would like to see a reaction, in which case, let me know down below. Maybe in the future I will do that. But for now, I will say, you know, I will check out his music sometime, someday. For now, I'm just kind of focusing on this series as well as new releases. But, you know, maybe I'll listen to it in the privacy of my own home and not in front of a camera. However, if you do want to see that, again, let me know. But that pretty much does it for Either Or by Elliot Smith. But if you want to see a folk album reaction, then go ahead and leave a comment down below with a different folk album suggestion. I will check it out throughout the month of February, assuming I have not already wrapped up the rest of the videos for the month. So again, go ahead and comment down below an album you would like to see me react to. And subscribe if you want to see more videos like this, as well as next month's genre, which will be starting quite soon, as well as new releases along the way throughout the year. As always, my name is Randy Joe, and I'm signing off.